Mark, our eldest boy, was born in 1975, and in the few years following that, I had two more children, John and Elizabeth, and we were still living in Auckland. I went back part-time to St. Helens after John was born and did weekend work there. Then we moved down to Dunedin in 1978, and Elizabeth was born in Dunedin in 1979. And after that, started to think that I would like to get into work in Dunedin because I hadn't been part of the workforce in Dunedin. I didn't have the same links. And I think this is something I discovered, and it came to me in a little bit more over time. But I realised then what quite a closed group the New Zealand physiotherapy community was. Everybody had done their training in the one place, and everybody knew each other. They either knew each other because they trained together, or they'd known each other, or they've all got links with the school. And so moving down to Dunedin, away from a group of people that I had got to know quite well over those early years in New Zealand, was quite a move for me that I didn't appreciate, I think, the significance of at the time. But I'd started working with the Parents Centre to do ante and postnatal work for them, and did that part-time in the evenings, and then moved into a part-time job at Queen Mary doing antenatal, postnatal work there with Margaret Borland, who was the charge physio there. And that carried on until 1987. I'd always had an interest in education. Over those years, when I wasn't working full-time, I'd become quite closely involved with my children's education, and so I'd been on committees and things at kindergartens and at the primary school and things like that. So my interest in education was there as well. And when the children all started school, as a mum, you think you need to be there for them when they come home from school, but there was all this time during the day when you think, what am I going to do with myself? Queen Mary was only a half-day job, it was only part-time, although we did evening classes there as well. And that's when the special education job at Forbury School here in Dunedin came up. And I thought, schools, school holidays, physio, 9 till 3, this all sounds quite attractive. So I applied for a job there and started there part-time, still working at Queen Mary. I have an exceptionally vivid memory of my last antenatal class night I did at Queen Mary, because we used to do it in the building next door to, which is now Hayward Hall at the University of Otago. It's a hall of residence now. And I think where we used to do the antenatal classes is now the School of Surveying. But up there, I remember arriving to do the last class, decided I did need to go to the toilet before I did the class, and got myself locked in the door. And I really started to panic because I thought, how am I going to get out of this place? There was nobody else around, and I don't know whether I'd watched too much TV, but I can remember doing the kung fu thing on the door and kicking the door in and having to write a note to explain to the manager why the door in the ladies' toilet, the lock was broken, because I'd had to kick the door in. Because it was my last day and I wasn't going back again, I put it under the door as I left the hospital that night. So that was the end of any antenatal and postnatal work I did. Forbury School had what was called an attached unit. Basically, there were two types of establishments back then. There was what was called a special school, so you could have a school that was dedicated to the needs of a particular group of students. So there were several schools around New Zealand that were called special schools for children with physical disabilities or physical handicaps, actually, as it was back then. Or there might have been just small classes attached to a regular primary school. And Forbury had a class attached to it as a primary school. They employed physiotherapists, occupational therapists, speech-language therapists. There was a paediatrician visited once a week and did a clinic. We had teacher aides. And back then, we had a physiotherapy room. It had a treatment plinth in it. We had curtains that you drew around. We had parallel bars. This might sound quite what you would expect, but it certainly isn't the way we provide services in education today, so that's why when I think about it, it is quite reminiscent of a physiotherapy department. And the way things were worked was that the children attended Forbury between the ages of 5 and 21, so this was a primary school with children over that whole range. Some of them were in regular classrooms in the school, and some of them were in a classroom that was part of the unit, as we called it, and we had several young men 18, 19, 20 years old at the school as well. It all goes back to the way these establishments were set up at the beginning of the 50s, as a result of the visit of a gentleman called Dr. Earl Carlson, who came over from the States. But basically, the idea was they believed that if you had a physical handicap, you needed as much physio and as much OT as many times a week as you possibly could. So the timetable was, if you could fit it in, you saw everybody every day. They had some physio, you'd go in, they might have some passive movements and stretching. There might be some rehabilitation for these kids for walking and whatever their needs were. But there wasn't any expectation that they did any of that when they went back to the classroom. They went to the classroom to do their maths or whatever it is they were doing. They'd go down to see the OT who would do cooking and sewing and whatever else the OTs were doing at the time. But it was while I was there, I met an occupational therapist from Scotland, Moray, her name was, who had been working in a different way, looking at individuals' needs and working in a team to develop programs and bring in activities that were going to meet those needs and develop the skills and work towards whatever the goals had been decided for the student or the young person, but not just necessarily within the therapy. So her model was that the teacher could become involved in this as well. So I can remember we started moving into the classroom there, and I would help set up the student in the standing frame. She would be there to do whatever the fine motor skill it was they needed, and the teacher would say, we're doing some maths today and we're doing some counter work or we're doing some block work or something like that. So Moray would facilitate the fine motor skill part of the activity while I was there to monitor the standing frame or whatever was happening there, and the teacher was setting up the learning program. And that was the first time I'd thought about working in that way. So that was quite influential on me. The other thing that was really influential at this time was that I'd had the cheek to apply for this job, but I actually had never done any paediatrics apart from a placement while I was training. And so I was really aware of my lack of knowledge. This was before Tomorrow's Schools in New Zealand, and so schools at that time weren't self-governing. They didn't have their own budgets, and so money had to come from the then Department of Education. And in giving me the job, the Department of Education had said they would make an allowance of some money to allow me to go and visit other places and to find out about how I was supposed to be doing this work that they employed me to do. They let me go up to Auckland for a week. And I went up to Auckland and I visited Carlson Cerebral Palsy School, which was another of these things, you know, just down the road from where we'd lived in Auckland. And I went over to Wilson Home. And at Wilson Home, I met Glenys Lobb, who, while I was there, said to me, oh, you'll know about this course that they're going to be doing in Dunedin. And I said, oh, what's this? And she said, oh, she said, we got this thing in the mail. And she rooted through her filing cabinet and she pulled out this flyer that said, Advanced Diploma in Physiotherapy Pediatrics, starting in Dunedin, distance learning. Gaywood was going to be the person who was organising this through the physiotherapy school. And I said, no, I haven't heard about this at all. I brought the information back down to Dunedin with me and contacted the School of Physiotherapy in Dunedin, that was at the Polytech at that time, and yes, indeed, the course was about to take off. Yes, they would accept an application, and my application was accepted. So I embarked in 1988 on a two-year part-time advanced diploma that Gay ran with Lucy Hastings, who that time was based in Palmerston North. She was a physio who'd come from the States via Curtin, where she'd done her master's degree. So for the next 2 years, we met via teleconference on Thursday afternoons. We had 3 two-week blocks of time when we all got together as part of the course. Yvonne Burns was the visiting lecturer from Brisbane, who was the paediatric specialist who would come in and spent a lot of time with us. There might have been about 9 or 10 of us. Margaret Davidson was one of those physios. There was Ainsley Duncan, who's now up in Auckland, I think. Gabriella from Christchurch. Celia Duffy from Invercargill. Val Cameron from Wellington. And several others who I apologise for their names that I've forgotten now. But we had a great 2 years. Yvonne Burns was a great mentor. But Yvonne Burns was an inspirational lady. She just had so much knowledge, and I know there were videos taken of some of her the classes that she did and the the things that she did. And I still remember, there are these little things that you remember that you've been taught over the years. I remember Yvonne Burns saying, if you're assessing, assess. Don't do an intervention because it will influence your assessment. So if you're going to assess the child, just assess, keep your hands away, just see what they're doing, just set them up, give them the pieces of equipment or whatever it is you want them to interact with, but don't try and intervene while you're assessing because it will cloud the information you're gathering. So 2 years, I can remember being so proud walking across the stage at the Regent Theatre here in Dunedin when that group graduated. Robin Grota was the head of physio school then. I think she might have put some people's noses out because she had a PhD. And I have a feeling that Ian Hall, who was our next door neighbour at the time, who was the head of the Polytech, didn't. And I just remember her wonderful regalia standing on stage there as we all marched across with our gowns. Because, of course, as I said, I just got a letter when I finished my physio training, so I hadn't ever graduated before. But I have to say, what this did was it gave me an addiction that I have never got over, and that's for learning.